Geometry and Algebra of Vectors. In linear algebra, the concepts are as important as the computations. In practical terms, linear algebra is a brand new language. If you want to learn this language the same way you would a foreign language, you must practice it with daily work and effort. Alright, for the most part, linear algebra is primarily about vectors and is central to modern mathematics and its applications. For example, many measurable quantities such as length, area, volume, mass, and temperature can be completely described by specifying their magnitude. Other quantities such as velocity, force, and acceleration require both a magnitude and direction for their description. We call these quantities vectors. If we take a look at the Cartesian plane with the familiar x and y axis, we can define a vector as a directed line segment that corresponds to a displacement from one point, say A, to another point, say B. This vector from point A to point B is denoted as follows. The way we denote vectors resembles the way we denoted line segments back in your geometry class, but instead of just having a bar on top, we have an arrow going from left to right. This arrow symbolizes a vector. Another way of denoting a vector is by using a single boldface and lowercase letter, as follows. When writing vectors by hand, it is difficult to create boldface letters unless you have a special pen of some sort at your disposal. So what we can do to fix this problem is to use the single letter form and just add an arrow on top, like this, to denote vectors. And this is the way that I will identify vectors in all the linear algebra videos from here and on. When describing vectors, point A is called the initial point or tail of the vector, and point B is called the terminal point or head of the vector. When we talk about vectors, we are usually referring to the standard position of a vector. These are vectors whose initial point, or tail, is located at the origin, with coordinates 0, 0. And its terminal point, or head, is located anywhere else on the Cartesian coordinate plane. In the same way that points are represented by using coordinates, so are vectors. For example, point A is typically represented using parentheses, like this. If you want to denote a vector, say vector V, you replace the parentheses with square brackets, like this. Likewise, vector u is represented as negative 1, 3, all enclosed in a square bracket. And vector w is represented as 2, negative 1, again, inside a square bracket. Notice that vectors can be considered as ordered pairs of real numbers, just like points. Taking a look at vector v, we see that the vector is created by starting at the origin and moving 3 units to the right, in the direction of the x-axis, and 2 units up in the direction of the y-axis. In other words, vector v is defined as 3, 2. You can think of the first number inside the square brackets as the run, and the second number as the rise, analogous to the way we find the slope of a line. But in this case, we are only interested on the number of units we move in the x-direction and the number of units we move in the y-direction, not their quotient. These numbers are called the components of the vector. Because of the fact that vectors are a type of ordered pair of real numbers, the order is important since a vector with components 3, 2 is different when compared to a vector with components 2 and 3. Remember, the first component represents the direction of the x-axis, and the second corresponds to the direction of the y-axis. In general, two vectors are equal if and only if the corresponding components are equal. Let's go back and take a look at vector v. There are two ways to denote vectors. The first form is called row vector form, and the alternative form is called column vector form. This form is convenient from a computational point of view. It helps to organize your work in a very concise form. So this is the form that I will use from this point on. Just keep in mind that both the row form and the column form are used in linear algebra. And remember that vectors are ordered pairs. This means that the first number represents the direction in the x-axis, and y represents a direction in a y-axis. Regardless of what form you use, they are like points. They are ordered pairs. The set of all vectors with two components that are ordered pairs is denoted by R2, where R denotes the set of real numbers from which the components of vectors in R2 are chosen. This means that vectors whose components are equal to negative 1 and 2.5, or square root of 3, pi, or 5/3 and 2, are all in R2. These include the rational and irrational numbers of the real number system. Okay, now that you know how vectors are described, has it ever occurred to you what the vector with components 0, 0 looks like? but you can't really draw it. Nevertheless, it is a perfectly good vector and has a special name, the zero vector. The zero vector is denoted as 0 with the vector notation on top, or we can just use the number 0. Now let's talk about vectors that are not in standard form. Here we have a vector that is in standard form because the tail is located in the origin. And here we have vectors that are not in standard form because their tails are not located in the origin. If you look closely at the vectors, it seems like they have a couple of things in common. For starters, they all have the same length. And secondly, they are all pointing in the same direction. In other words, their components are equal. Here's some etymology for you. The word component is derived from the Latin word co, meaning together with, and poner, meaning to put. Thus, a vector is put together out of its components. Let's prove that these three vectors are the same by showing that their components are the same. First, let's start with vector v, because that one is in standard form. All we need to do is start from the origin and move 2 units to the right. This will be our x component of vector v. Then move 2 units up. This will be our y component of the vector. So vector v has an x component of 2 and a y component of 2. Looking at vector u, we see that the tail, point d, has coordinates negative 2, 0. And the head, point e, has coordinates 0, 2. One way to find the components is to just count the rise and run to get from point d to point e. It turns out that we need to go 2 units to the right and 2 units up. Thus, vector u is defined component-wise as 2, 2. Another way to find the components when we are given the coordinates of the tail and head of the vector is to find the difference between the x-coordinates of points d and e. This represents the x-component. And the difference between the y-coordinates of points d and e. This will represent the y-components of the vector. So we have the following. The difference of the x-coordinates is equal to 0 minus minus 2, which is equal to 2. And the difference of the y-coordinates is equal to 2 minus 0, which signifies to 2. Notice that the x-component of a vector represents how much the vector travels in that direction. In this case, 2 units along the x-axis. And the y-component is the distance it travels along the y-axis, which is 2 units as well. Alright, let's use the same technique to find the components of vector w using the coordinates of the tail and head of the vector. So we see that point B has coordinates 1, negative 2, and point C has coordinates 3, 0. So now we find the difference between the x-coordinates to find the x-components, and find the difference between the y-coordinates of the points to find the y-component of the vector. So we have the vector w in component form is equal to 3 minus 1, which signifies the 2, and 0 minus minus 2, which signifies the 2. So it turns out that all the vectors are the same. Once again, we define two or more vectors to be equal if they have the same length and the same direction. In other words, their components are equal. Even though vectors u, v, and w have different initial and terminal points, they represent the same displacement. Geometrically, two vectors are equal if one can be obtained by sliding or translating the other parallel to itself until the two vectors coincide. So doing that, we see that they actually coincide. Notice that vectors in component form represents a vector in standard form. In other words, a vector whose tail is located in the origin. In general, every vector can be drawn as a vector in standard position given its coordinates. When vectors are referred to by their coordinates, they are being considered analytically. Conversely, a vector in standard position can be redrawn by translation so that its tail is at any point in the plane. For example, say we had a vector whose tail is located at negative 1, 2, and head is located at 2, 3, and we are asked to redraw the vector in standard form. And redraw it with a tail represented by point C at negative 2, negative 2. So redrawing it in standard form is pretty easy. All we need to do is find the components of the vector. So we find the difference of the x-coordinates of the points and find the difference of the y-coordinates of the points. So doing that, we obtain the following. Vector AB is going to be equal to 2 minus negative 1, which signifies to 3, and 3 minus 2, which signifies to 1. So now that we have the components, we redraw the vector in standard form. We start from the origin. This represents the tail of the vector in standard form, and move 3 units to the right and 1 unit up. In other words, we stop at point 3, 1. We were also asked to redraw the vector with the tail located at point C, with coordinates negative 2, negative 2. So we first plot point C, and then use the components of the vector to generate the new point D, which represents the head of the vector. So we start from negative 2, and move 3 units to the right, then move 1 unit up. So our new point is 1, negative 1. Alright, make sure you understand what a vector is from a geometric point of view and an algebraic point of view. The geometric point of view will be useful to aid us in understanding the concepts in linear algebra. An algebraic point of view is going to be needed when we start getting our hands dirty and work on the computation aspect of linear algebra. In our next video, we will continue with vectors and learn how to add them geometrically and algebraically.